Maybe see. Happy birthday, Bert.
Oh, convention several years ago, and we went to Fort McHenry, because it was in Baltimore. And it's really kind of a fascinating thing to go back there and see the way things were back in the early days. And you realize that the writing of the Star Spangled Banner was as a result of the fact that the Brits came after us. And even though we had already declared our independence from them, and it, we were doing things, beginning life in America and all that kind of stuff, they decided they wanted a second shot at us, and they came back. And if it weren't for the bravery of some wonderful soldiers, I started to say we'd be speaking English today, but that doesn't quite work, does it? Or something close. But anyway, it's a moving experience. So if you're ever in Baltimore, and you can just kind of slide over to Fort McHenry and get to see the different. They could turn it into a little museum, and you can see about the Star Spangled Banner being written. It's really kind of moving. Well, we come to that time in our service where we open the Word of God. So I invite you to turn to 1 John chapter 3. And our text this morning is verses 19 to 24. So if you're able to, please stand with me in honor of the reading of the Word of God. First John chapter 3, beginning in verse 19. It says, "We will know by this that we are of the truth and will assure our heart before Him in whatever our heart condemns us. For God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from Him because we keep His commandments and do the things that are pleasing in His sight. This is His commandment, that we believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as He commanded us. The one who keeps His commandments abides in Him, and He in him. We know by this that He abides in us by the Spirit whom He has given us." Would you pray with me, please? Father, we thank You again for this powerful passage, this entire section of this wonderful letter, written to give us the complete assurance of our salvation, and to provide for us a way to test within others whether or not their salvation experience is indeed sincere. So we pray, Father, as we open this particular passage, we pray that You will show us exactly what You want us to know and what You want us to apply to our lives so that we can be more like You as we live our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. A belief system, or a worldview, if you will, is extremely important. How one views the world, the distinction and the origin of right and wrong, will affect everything that he or she does. One's worldview colors everything that one does. And it needs to be consistent. For example, biblical worldviews and atheistic politics are inconsistent. Every human alive has a certain measure of understanding when it comes to right and wrong. The philosopher, mathematician Aristotle wrote about this 400 years before Christ, but the Apostle Paul put a godly spin on it by noting in Romans 2, 14 and 15, it says, "For when Gentiles who do not have the law do instinctively the things of the law, these, not having the law, are a law to themselves, in that they show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience bearing witness, and their thoughts alternately accusing or else defending them." Now this is a relatively deep topic here. You understand that there are things that people can know that's right and wrong that does not require a commandment. Now, the commandments cover these things, but still, people know innately certain things are wrong. So since everyone has this general understanding of right and wrong, then one's worldview can then fill in the blanks of how one lives. Let me just take you back a few years. I'm convinced that a suicide bombing mission, if I am convinced that a suicide bombing mission will immediately send my soul into heaven where I will be served by 72 virgins, then a lie has impacted what I believe about right and wrong. In that instance, then, murdering innocent people would be justified in the minds of the suicide pilot. But without the special revelation of the truth of Scripture, people can convince themselves that they are right even when they're not. Political correctness of the postmodern era forbids us from standing against the beliefs that stand opposed to ours. But we don't need to delve any deeper in a comparison to see that love your enemies, those teachings of Jesus are superior to the teachings of Muhammad that say, kill the infidels. You see that huge juxtaposition here, this contrast. Jesus said, love your enemies. Muhammad says, kill all infidels. It's hard to imagine something even starker than that. So in order for us to know what is right and what is wrong, then we have to know the teachings of Scripture. And even then, we can struggle with our own assurances and our doubts. Someone who comes to Christ as an adult and has a history of sin that causes some embarrassment and approaches things from a different perspective from someone who came to Christ as a child and whose worst sin might be lying or being prideful. In God's eyes, however, the sin is the same. Human eyes have a tendency to remember sin too long. This is another instance where we fail to grasp fully grace. How can God forgive my fill-in-the-blank sin? But honestly, folks, we cheat God when we drag around the baggage of old sin simply because we cannot trust that he has forgiven it. In this particular passage, the Apostle John is going to connect our faith with our minds. Again, running in an opposite direction of these Gnostics, these people who claim to have this special knowledge that were creating a problem for the early church. But John's going to allow his readers to do spiritual self-examinations. He will give us a list of the things for which we can thank God and by which we can know that we're truly saved. The assurance of the condition of John's readers then and now can be strengthened. Their consciences could be pure, and their walk with the Lord would give evidences of this grace. Let's look in verses 19 and 20. We'll see that love assures our hearts. Verse 19 says, we will know by this that we are of the truth and will assure our heart before him in whatever our heart condemns us. For God is greater than our heart and knows all things. When he says, by this, we have to look back and remember back to where we were last week when we looked at brotherly love. You remember he stresses the importance of loving one another, especially within a church. The Christians should love one another. If we have difficulty expressing brotherly love, and don't just kind of limit that by gender here, by brotherly love we're talking about all Christians, right? Then we don't have the assurance of our salvation because it has manifested itself in a fleshly and selfish manner. And on the same line of thinking, a true expression of brotherly love is evidence that we are of the truth. So this is what you have to see here is he's making a serious point here. If you believe and you love. And I'll get to that, come back to that in a minute. But from a humanistic perspective, unconditional love makes no sense whatsoever. From a humanistic perspective. Altruism. You've heard this word. Altruism means it's a selfless kind of love. It was modeled in the parable of the Good Samaritan. Cannot be explained by evolutionists. It cannot be explained by people who maintain the argument of survival of the fittest. Doesn't fit within that argument. Selfless love is not simply a premise in the argument against evolution, though it's a basic requirement for a Christian. In the times when our sin is inward, for example, pride, something like that, our sin is inward, is not as obvious as other sins, or even if we've been using some bad theology to defend our faith, our conscience generally requires the work of the Holy Spirit to reveal or to expose certain sinful attitudes. We talked about this in the pastor's class. There are times when you and I don't walk as closely with the Spirit as we can, and then a lot of times as a result we stumble over some sins. We don't have the Spirit convicting us so that we're not going back to God and asking forgiveness for these sins. It requires walking closely with Him, being in Him. This is one of the great secret weapons of the Christian faith. We have the ability to have our hearts return to a peaceful mode because we know that we are of the truth. Amen? Amen. We have the truth. Everybody is seeking the truth. We have it. Even if we can't articulate as well as we feel that we should, we know that what we believe is true. And apologetics, or the defense of the gospel, then the only things that we have against us is that God is invisible. Therefore, we cannot prove with our senses His existence. How do we know? We know. But isn't it great that an astounding amount of evidence supports the claims of the Bible? What do atheists have? They can only point to the immeasurability of God. And then what we've seen in the last few decades is the non-existence, they think, of sin. What a great move. What a great strategy on their part. We take somebody away from the need for a Savior by eliminating the concept of sin altogether. There's no such thing as sin. Well, you and I know better. And if you don't know better, just hang around me for the next few minutes and I'll give you some examples. You'll know what sin is by the time you spend some time with me. But isn't it great when we mess up, however it manifests itself, we can be assured of His love and His forgiveness. Amen? We can be assured of that. We may have reason to be upset with ourselves, but we shouldn't stay there long, because it gives evidence to the fact that we really don't trust God, that He has truly forgiven our little boo-boos or our big boo-boos. Don't focus on the failure. Focus on the Father, who knows that your intention was to do the right thing. And so, in the part of the mind that seats the conscience, which we just saw, we know that we've sinned. If we believe that God is omniscient, then we are forced to admit that God knows not only our actions that are sinful, but He also knows our intentions, which are impossible for other humans to discern. Now listen, before we blow past that, I want you to understand that when you and I sit around and try to discern someone else's motives, we run dangerously close to becoming Pharisees. This is the job of the Holy Spirit. This is not my job. This is not your job. Trying to figure out why somebody did something, what motivates somebody to do something, is dangerous. We carry the burden of our sin to God, and His forgiveness of that sin allows us to know and experience His love, and it allows us to exhibit that same love to other people. Since God knows everything, then He is able to penetrate into the recesses of our mind and to check our motives and to clean our slates whenever we ask Him to do so. Now, verse 19 here kind of connects us with the previous verse, and it also moves us forward, connects us into verse 20. This is a powerful and encouraging verse. Christians can know that their salvation is real and is evidenced by their love for what? Other Christians. Right off the bat. If you fail in this regard, you have failed one of the most basic tests. Now listen, we want a fellowship with other Christians. I got pastor friends who talk, they actually regret starting an internet ministry, because what happens is when COVID came along, then people would decide, you know what, I think I'll just stay at home and I don't have to worry about shaking people's hands. And I don't have, you know, I could just drink coffee and watch the service in my jammies. And then that's fine. I won't even have to mess with it. Now, the problem with that is it totally eliminates the fellowship aspect of it. We need each other. But this particular church likes the fellowship. Y'all notice that? We like to spend time together. We like to exchange ideas and projects, and when possible, we like to meet people's needs. At the same time, we should be able to confess our sins to one another. I'm not real good at that, y'all. And as a result of that, our conscience is activated, as we see in the phrase, whatever our heart condemns us. So we know that we've got a conscience, and if you're a Christian, then your conscience is really busy. It's highly active, because our consciences as Christians should be well informed, because we spend a lot of time studying the Bible. Amen? If we study the Bible, then we know what's right and what's wrong, in addition to what is naturally, what is innate to us. Every human is born with the mechanism that's referred to as a conscience. And if you're not familiar, that word basically means, the English word conscience means that you're simply, it's self-awareness. You can kind of break it apart through the word con, and then you put the word science next to it. Conscience. It's an ability to recognize what's going on in you. So we finish verse 20, we see its power here. A conscience that is focused on our failures attacks us with healthy guilt. And it chops away at overconfidence in the flesh. And yet, there is a higher court than our consciences. And He is certainly more reliable than our emotions. Is that right? Y'all agree with that? God certainly is more reliable than my heart. He's greater than my heart. He knows all things. Now listen, He hates sin much more than my conscience does, and He knows much more than my emotions do. Simply put, God has a higher standard of holiness than I do. God has a greater hatred of sin than I do. And God knows everything about me far more than even I do. Let's look at verses 21 and 22. We'll see that love creates confidence. Love creates confidence. 21 says, "Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. Whatever we ask, we receive from Him, because we keep His commandments and do the things that are pleasing in His sight." So I hear he describes someone who has had his or her sins forgiven so that the heart does not condemn. Romans 8:1 says, "Therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." And when your conscience is accusing you, then you go back to that position of gratitude for the grace that you have received from God. Because as I just said, God knows your sin far better than you do. God has a higher standard than you do. And God has, if you trusted in Jesus Christ alone for your salvation, then God has pronounced you justified. That doesn't mean that you take sin lightly, but you avoid self-condemnation. You have to ask yourself, do you have a love for God's people? Are you grateful for His grace? Does your heart reach out in holy love to God and to see the one you desire to honor and to please? So no matter what your conscience and your heart may say to you, God is greater than your heart. By this we know that we're of truth because we love other believers and because we are thankful for the grace of God. God, greater in knowledge, greater in holiness than our hearts, has promised us that we are His and He is faithful to His own. So whatever sin that could have broken our fellowship with God is lovingly removed by those who have confessed sin, permanently turned away from it, and purposed to following the teachings of Christ. And as a result, we can approach God without bringing garbage into His presence, because He has removed the trash from our alleys of life. We have to approach God in order to get cleaned up. And when we get cleaned up, we can approach God with the firm knowledge that nothing can take us from Him. Let me read a couple of passages that support that idea. John 10:24 and following. The Jews then gathered around Him and were saying to Him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I told you, and you do not believe me. The works that I do in my Father's name, these testify of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give eternal life to them, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." And then another very familiar passage, Romans 8:31 and following. Paul says, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him over for us all, how will He not also with Him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is He who died. Yes, rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Just as it is written, 'For your sake we are being put to death all day long. We were considered as sheep to be slaughtered.' But in all these things we overwhelmingly conquer through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor any created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen. How can sinful people be confident before our holy God? This is where our understanding of grace needs to be continually developing. Our sin and our human limitations should prevent us from approaching God in a flippant and cocky manner. But once we have repented of our sin and our miscues, then we can come to Him with the assurance that He is for us and that His love is unconditional and limitless. It's still irreverent, I think, to speak to God as if He were simply an old pal. We need to find the balance, knowing that the one who spoke creation into existence and knows when every sparrow falls longs to be intimately involved in our lives. We need to understand that longing in order to experience God to the maximum. When this verse is violently jerked out of context, and it is often, then it can be twisted into a name it and claim it support. He's not discussing mansions here. He's talking about the assurance of salvation. We don't obey his commands to receive material things. We obey out of gratitude, not compulsion or guilt or selfishness. And when we obey, our lives please God. There is no inkling of merit whatsoever. Anything good that comes out of my life is a result of the love and the gratitude. Jesus spent his entire ministry doing things that please God. Back in John's Gospel, chapter 8, verse 29, Jesus says, "And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone. For I always do the things that are pleasing to him." So you see, legalism is not the issue here. Love is. Now you can see as we go through this and go through the rest of this passage, you can see there's a short list here of things that true believers should love. And in fact, Jonathan Edwards, I mentioned before, is the great Puritan theologian. He was used mightily by God in the first Great Awakening in the 18th century. And he's best known for his sermon, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." Powerful stuff. You can get your hands on a copy, and if you've got some time, sit down and read it. This is a sermon. It took him 3 hours to deliver it. And you guys complain about how long I preach. However, as America's Christianity was growing and there was confusion over whether the church was as diligent as she should be, doubt concerning people's faith began to spread. And then Edwards then wrote a book entitled "A Treatise Concerning Religious Affections." This particular chapter of 1 John gives us a brief list of such religious affections that demonstrate someone's faith as being true or false. Already we've seen how the love of other believers and how we should love the grace of God determine the sincerity of our faith. In verse 21, we see how we should love being bold in prayer. Bold in prayer. Because if our heart no longer is condemning us, then we have confessed those sins. If we get past those sins and our conscience is again condemning us, then we find ourselves with the kind of confidence that causes us to rush into the presence of God and whatever we ask, we will receive from him. And it's not something. It's not a material thing. It's just being right with him. I've let my behavior get to the point where I'm separated from him. And when that happens, I should run back to him. I should run back to him. Not to plead for some new thing or a new house or car or some new toy, something like that. I should plead with him so that my relationship with him would be the best that it could possibly be. And what does that require? Confession. Repentance. That's it. And at first glance, this seems a little bit presumptuous, doesn't it? The Greek word there for confidence here literally means boldness. And if your conscience is clear, then this is another religious affection that causes you to run into the presence of God and to pour out whatever's on your heart. If we have an open relationship where we can look into the eyes of God with freedom from fear, freedom to ask, and the freedom to give him anything that's on our heart and know that whatever we ask we receive from him, as long as it fits within his perfect and will and pleasure. This is not the first time that John has brought it up, and guess what? It won't be the last. We not only have confidence at the end when we face the Lord and we stand before him knowing our sins are paid for in Christ, we have confidence now to rush into his presence and ask for anything according to his will, and we know that he will hear us and we will receive it. See, this is where a lot of people in the church get messed up. This is not something. This is a relationship with him. And when our relationship with him gets right, then guess what? The relationship with the church gets right. And when the relationship with the church gets right, guess what happens? We become evangelists. So this is evidence of a changed heart. The sinner has no passion to run into the presence of God and unload all the passions of his heart to speak freely to God. But the saint does, and he knows that anything that he asks within the will of God, he's going to receive because God has promised to meet all his needs. It's amazing to me. God loves to hear us confess our sins. Loves getting right, getting me right with him. So how do you know that you're a Christian? Well, what have we seen so far? Because you have love for other believers, you have love for God himself, and that love is driven at the greatness of his grace, and then there's this boldness that comes before God. A love for brothers, a gratitude for his grace, a boldness in prayer. And then there's another item that you'll see in verse 22. We'll see the desire for holy obedience. We keep his commandments. Those who are true believers are known by their obedience. We're motivated by what pleases God. 1 Corinthians 10:31. I love this verse. It's pretty simple. Whether then you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Don't get hung up on some of the Old Testament rituals about eating and drinking and washing hands and all the other kind of stuff. But whatever you do, do it so that God will receive the glory. It'll change your life. And obedience is clearly indicated at every point in the New Testament. In every command given to believers, it's a joy rather than a hassle. Now, one quick little word study here might help. The word there for keep is the same word that's used to describe the shepherds who were keeping watch over their flocks by night that we read about at Christmas. Obeying the commands of God are as important, if not more important, to the true believer than sheep to the shepherds. Let's look at verse 23. We'll see that love indicates belief. 23 says, this is his commandment that we believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. So, very simply, if we believe, we love. We love. Just like us, there are few, if any, of the original readers of this letter had seen Jesus, but his name represents all that he did and all that he taught while he was on earth. You remember Acts 4:12 if you're in the pastor's class not too long ago. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. No other name. And once again, agape. We talked about this last week. Unconditional love. The Greek word is agape. It's not a feeling. It's about a will and a choice. John 15:12 says, this is my commandment. Jesus says, this is my commandment that you love one another just as I have loved you. So belief and faith and trust in Christ and love for the brethren are alloyed. They are inseparable. You can't have one without the other. If we say one, we must do the other. This is basic and essential for all Christians. When we catch ourselves not accomplishing this, we must return to God for restoration. And again, this is not a humanistic thing that will automatically happen. It cannot occur outside of the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, here's another love item to add to your list. This is another guarantee that I'm a Christian. We believe in Jesus Christ. Not rocket science theology here. When it says we believe in the name, it doesn't just mean the name in the sense of his title. The name of Jesus is all that he is. It's everything about him. This is a repeated theme in 1 John as well as the entire New Testament. Believing in the Lord Jesus Christ is critical. You're a Christian when you believe in Jesus Christ is all that he is, who he was, why he came, and what he did. Now let's look at verse 24. We'll see the love from God's Spirit helps us obey. Verse 24 says, "The one who keeps his commandments abides in him." And he, capital H, in him. We know by this that he abides in us. By the Spirit, capital S, whom he has given us. So if brotherly love among Christians is evidence in our faith, then obedience is evidence of our abiding in him. Now this sounds familiar. He just wrote about this. We just read about this, verse 19. We know that God abides in us. We're truly his children. We're his people. He lives in us. We abide in him. We share common life with God by the Spirit whom he has given us. If we've ever been filled with the Spirit, led by the Spirit, if we've ever been directed by the Spirit, instructed by the Spirit, taught of the Spirit, graced by the Spirit, gifted by the Spirit, filled with the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, self-control, all those ministries of the Holy Spirit are evidence of the Spirit's presence. When we abide in the Spirit, we know that everything that we do that glorifies God is empowered by the Holy Spirit. This is how he abides in us. And we also need to understand the concept of abiding in Christ. We have a human tendency to relate to God much like a book or a trophy on a shelf. And we can say that at some point we understood our need for a Savior, and so we did what was necessary to escape the biblical teaching of eternity in hell. And thus our faith actually sits like a trophy on a mantle or a bookcase, and it collects dust, but it looks good for the visitors. It's also like a book, in that whenever we need it, we can flip through it for advice. We don't pull it out until we need it. That's wrong. But this is a huge distance away from what Jesus taught us when he taught us to abide in him. Because someone who abides is someone who never leaves. He has promised us in a number of instances he would never leave us. If you want to jot this one down, Hebrews 13:5. Why then do we occasionally leave him until some point in time that's more convenient for us? Why do we put him away from us, much like placing a pet on the back porch, only to retrieve him at our pleasure? True believers have grown past that and understand that abiding in him means never leaving him. It means understanding that every thought, word, or action includes him, and even more, is empowered by him. John 15:5 says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." So how far apart do we have to be able to do nothing? We can actually give the appearance that the branches are connected to the vine without actually being connected. In the Christian walk, being almost grafted is not the same thing as abiding. We have to know the difference in order to walk with him. So there's a mystery to the working of the Holy Spirit that we certainly don't have enough time left to exhaust. But if you've been a Christian for any time at all, you've seen the power of the Spirit of God expressed in your life. When your unregenerate soul was made alive and your blind eyes were made to see and your sinful heart came to a point of repentance, and you, without any faith in Christ Jesus. You weren't born with it. All of a sudden, we're drawn to Christ. No man calls Jesus Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Having called Jesus Lord, you have then experienced the Holy Spirit's work. Then you were placed into the body of Christ. You were gifted. And through the ministry of your gift, the Holy Spirit blesses your church. You've given testimony to the gospel, and the Spirit has empowered that testimony. The Word of God has come alive to you because the Spirit has become your teacher. You have prayed, and the Spirit has energized those prayers, and prayers have been answered. You have evidence of the work of the Spirit in your life. This is how you know. You see the hand of the Spirit providentially orchestrating things in your life to bring you to the right place at the right time to accomplish exactly the right thing in the perfection of God's purposes. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. All those holy longings are really energized by the Holy Spirit. So here's a quick summary of what we can be thankful for based on this passage. God's grace, the best that we can understand it, confidence of our assurance in praying, obedience to His teachings, the brotherly love that comes from faith, and the gift of the Holy Spirit who glorifies His Son, illuminates Scripture for us and convicts us of our sin when our flesh gets in the way. We cannot physically prove the existence of God, but we can submit evidence that would hopefully be strong enough to point only to Him. The greatest apologetics tool that we have is the transformation of the apostles from cowards to bold, brilliant missionaries once the Spirit came into their lives. And the transformed, regenerated life of any believer should produce enough love that the world will see the difference and want to know Him in the same way that you and I know Him. Your list now should consist of love for other Christians, gratitude toward God, boldness in prayer, obedience, faith in Jesus Christ, and the blessings of the indwelling Holy Spirit. This is how we know that we're truly saved. But if you want to prioritize them based on 1 John, you'll see in verse 23 that one, we should love one another. And two, because we love Him, we obey Him. One last quick word study note. These verbs are all in the present tense in Greek. All of them. So what can you draw from that? It's continuous action. You don't stop loving. You don't stop obeying. By this, we are assured that we are all true followers of Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we just reflect on the fact that Your love is limitless, that it is boundless, that it is unconditional. We thank You for the fact that You have loved us even when we were unlovable. And as a result of that, Father, that we can love one another. And as a result of that, Father, that we can obey Your teachings and we can follow in the ways that please You. Father, we just ask that You hear our prayer. We pray that it'll be a sweet aroma in your nose. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Mark and Taylor are here. You're going to lead us in a couple of verses of a hymn of invitation. If there's any business that you need to do with the Lord, I'll be down front. Feel free to talk to me about anything you want to do business with the Lord about. While they play as they sing, I invite you to come.